Welcome to Lakes Church this morning. Glad you're here to worship with us. If you want to stand, we'll worship with you this morning.
Thank you. So we pour out our praise, we pour out our praise and show.
We're going to sing that bridge again.
Opportunity to show it. I'm not saying this because I'm in need, for I've learned to be content whatever the circumstances. I know what it is to be in need, and I know what it is to have plenty. I have learned the secret for being content in any and every situation, whether well fed or hungry, whether living in plenty or want. I can do all things through Him who gives me strength. Yet it is good for you to share in my troubles. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintances with the gospel, when I set out for Macedonia, not one church shared with me the matter of giving and receiving except only you. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid more once when I was in need. Not the desires or gifts, what I desire is more to be credited to your account. I receive full payment, for I have more than enough. I am amply supplied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent. They are the fragrant offerings, the acceptable sacrifice pleasing to God, and my God will meet all your needs according to the riches of his glory, Jesus Christ. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen.
Who was our reader? Freon? Thank you very much. Awesome. I like that new thing. I just kind of used to get on autopilot singing and getting into the worship music and then so I apologize. It was great. All right, we are in Philippians 4, right, what we just read. And we're going to finish the letter this morning. Philippians 4, verses 10 through 23. That's what we're going to do today. Knock that microphone down. I'm up here, so I show anything that can possibly be knocked down, I will. So make sure there. All right, we're coming to the end of the letter, right? And I know that's a foreign thing to many of us today. Actually, writing letters. You know, oh my goodness! I remember a few years ago reading an article by a historian. That was his job. He was talking about how historians, for the future, are going to have real difficulties, new challenges, writing biographies for great leaders. Because often today, leaders maybe do podcasts or radio shows or blogs or, you know, articles that they put online. There's not a lot of book writing or memoirs or journals, things like that, that historians can use to collect and kind of, you know, trace the lives of great leaders, as it did in decades and generations gone by. So it's becoming, so letters, wow, you know, it's kind of hard for us to sometimes, I mean, if I were to ask, when's the last time you got a letter from somebody? You may have to think about it. Now, I'm not talking about Christmas cards and birthday cards. I mean, an actual paper, you know what that is, right? With real thin white stuff that you write on. You've got paper, you know. I mean, no, I got a really long email or an Instagram. No, a letter, right? Well, in the old days, sometimes when a letter would end, there would be sometimes like some final requests or final regards or, hey, just really glad we could talk or really glad I could share this thing with you. Well, Paul kind of does that here at the end of this letter. And the reason he does is because, again, he started this church. Read the book of Acts. He started this congregation in Philippi. And the people of this church, as we'll find out, they did some things for Paul whenever he was in what we would call a tight spot. Now, we don't know what that tight spot was. But he was in a really difficult time. And presently, a difficult time on house arrest, right? And this church did what they could to support him and help him when they had the chance. And other churches, for whatever reasons we don't know, weren't able to. And Paul doesn't forget that. So Paul is going to complete this letter with some final observations or some thank yous to the church, as well as some of the most well-known comments in the letter come here at the last part of chapter 4. Right? They're almost as popular as John 3:16. Maybe have memorized, right? So we'll start in verse 10. Paul says, okay, now he's talked about, you know, rejoicing in the Lord and how the church needs to get along. Remember Euodia and Syntyche from last week. And so now, verse 10, I rejoice in the Lord greatly because once again you renewed your care for me. There was this other opportunity you found out about the situation I was in and you wanted to help me out. And instead of saying, we've helped this Yahoo out for years, let's move on to somebody else. No. They say, hey, Paul needs help again. Let's help him. And so Paul says, look, I rejoice in the Lord greatly because once again you renewed your care for me. You took another opportunity to minister to me. You were in fact concerned about me, but lacked the opportunity to show it. I mean, again, Paul doesn't have Facebook or Snapchat, you know, social media to be able to say hashtag in Roman prison for the next 2 years, hashtag may get my head cut off, hashtag help. You know, he can't do that, right? He doesn't have, so the Philippians, you know, they're trying to find out when they can, how Paul's doing, but when they don't know what's going on, so they can't help. So Paul's like, I know for a while you didn't have opportunity, but finally you did. Finally you had an opportunity, and when you did, you seized it to minister to them. And I don't say this out of need, for I've learned to be content in whatever circumstances I find myself. In other words, Paul says, I'm not thanking you with the ulterior motive of getting more from you. Okay. That is a very difficult thing for a lot of us to swallow in our culture. I mean, we all know as parents, Dad, you're the greatest dad in the world! And what's the dad who's wise, who's been a dad for more than 5 minutes, going to say to that?
What do you want?
What do you want? What do you need? What have you broken? How much did it cost? Right? You can't butter up. You can't con a con. Right? Because any parent that you have, I know it's hard to believe, that parent has been a kid. Right? And they tried to con their parents. And sometimes they did. So they've been conned. They're a former con. So you can't con a con. Right? Well, Paul's, I'm not saying these things because I want to butter you up the more. Paul says, let's just clear it here. I'm not saying thank you. I'm not saying that I rejoice so that I can claim it or hustle. Very important in church when we're dealing with each other that we do our best to be transparent. Not to basically try to be salesmen whenever we're trying to minister to each other. Paul says, I'm not trying to do that. And then verse 12, Paul says, now, to make sure you know that I'm not trying to get more out of you, I want you to know what kind of attitude I have, whether churches help me or not. And this is where we get one of the most famous verses in the letter. But I want you to see here, sometimes this most quoted idea in the letter sometimes gets misconstrued. Notice Paul says, I know, look, Philippians, I know both how to make do with little, and I know how to do with much, or with a lot, or in Texas, a whole heap and a lot. I know how to eat in McDonald's, or as a pauper, and I know how to eat as a king of Whataburger. I know both extremes, right? And yes, by the way, I think In-N-Out is below McDonald's.
Oh,
and I'm sorry. Yeah. I'm sorry.
Whoa.
It's Whataburger or nothing. Plus, I can do a little or a lot. In any and all circumstances, Paul says, I've learned the secret of being content, whether well-fed or hungry, whether in abundance or in need, and then Philippians 4:13. I'm able to do all things through Christ or through him who strengthens me. Now, notice here, a lot of times, this is one of the curses of chapters and verses. You can take something out and you can soundbite it. Right? It's not fun to be soundbited. You know, take one little statement, I hate her. Oh, he said I hate her. And then take that and apply it in any context you want to make somebody look bad. It's not a good thing. I was pastoring out in Sticks in Kentucky when I was going to seminary. And I got soundbited. Or actually, my wife got soundbited in the local paper. It's not fun. She was pregnant with Brian. And the hospital, we were in the metropolis of Utica, Kentucky, which was a zip code, not a town. And then town was about 8 miles north in Owensboro. So that's where we had to go to Owensboro. So not driving from here to Fireman. And the hospital, it was a good hospital, they had just finished a brand new maternity wing. So, you know, good timing. And they had this program where they had midwives who ran the program. But here's the thing. They were all doctors. Or virtually all. There might have been some of them. But virtually all the ones that started the program were midwives, but they were also doctors. So your midwife was Dr. So-and-so. And our insurance was able to connect with that new program. So we were Pentecostal. We were happy. new building, new wing, new program. There were new customers into the program, so all was good. Well, I won't give all the story, but skip a few items. The local paper wanted to come interview my wife. Well, they wanted to interview both of us, but I wasn't going to be there. I wasn't able to be there for the interview. And so we talked about, sure, why not? Interview was about an attorney. Sure. So I had to go to seminary the day the reporter came out. She interviewed Tabitha. I came home and said, Tabitha, all was fine. They asked about the program, why we were in it, what it does, how it's, you know, how it works. Okay. It was going to be in the section of the paper where it talks about community life. I can't remember what that's called. Paper, who knows what the newspaper is anymore. But anyway, there was a community life section, but I can't remember what you call it. So we got the paper, two or three days later, no alarm was going to be in it. Get the paper, open that section. The front page of that section, the article about the returning program, which Tabitha's interview, is the front of the article, the beginning of the article, and the headline was, I'm not going to get it exactly right, but the headline was basically, low-income families find benefit in new maternity program. And then the first line, Everett and Tabitha Berry, residents of New Kentucky, blah, blah, blah. So they were trying to, the article was trying to talk about welfare and social conflicts with the new program and how insurance companies were exploiting it. And we just happened to be in the, we weren't told that's what it was about. And so I'm all worried, thinking, I'm thinking the church is going to be upset because I think they don't pay me enough, and they're going to, I had all kinds of concerns. And I got soundbited. Everything got soundbited with something that had nothing to do with what we were wanting to be interviewed about. Well, Paul gets soundbited a lot with this verse. Okay? A lot of times people take this verse to mean, whatever it is I want to achieve in life, Jesus can help me do it. I want to get a better job. I want to get a raise. I want to have a better car, or a better this, or better that. And if I work hard enough, Jesus will give me the strength to be able to do it. It's not necessarily that it's wrong to ask the Lord to help us improve the quality of life. Don't misunderstand. But that's missing the gist of what Paul's talking about. This is what Paul means when in this part of the letter when he says, I can do all things in Christ. This is what he means. It's why you have a doctor's appointment and the doctor gives you a report that you don't like. And it says, you may have 2 years to live. Now can you quote Philippians 4:13? Or you come home and you find that your spouse has been doing things they shouldn't be doing and they're leaving. Philippians 4:13. Or you lose your job. The ultimate country song. You lose your job, you lose your girlfriend, you lose your dog all in one day. Except you don't go get drunk after it's over. That's all the extra part of it. All those things happen to you. Can you quote, whenever life throws everything at you that you don't see coming, now that's whenever you put the Philippians 4:13 under your eyes. That's when you go. That's what Paul said. Whenever you have everything you want and you're tempted to invest your confidence in what you have as opposed to who gave it to you, now you can quote Philippians 4:13. Now, Christ can strengthen me not to get consumed with success. See, it's hard. A lot of us think we don't know how to handle failure. Lord, why do you keep causing me to fail? Well, it could be because he knows you can't handle success. For every 1,000 people who learn how to handle failure, only 1 out of 1,000 learn how to handle success. Talk to athletes. talk to me. It's an easy example, right? Paul's saying when life is just crushing me, I know I can withstand because of Christ who strengthens me. It's not about achieving what I want. It's about being able to endure whatever the Lord puts in my path. That's why Paul says, I learn to be content. A lot of things in life can't change. So what do? Get bitter about it, angry about it, resentful about it, or see it as an opportunity for the Lord to sustain you. See, Philippians 4:13 is gritty. Right? It's not just a nice picture with a dove on it that you can buy in Mardell, or a good church bulletin, right, cover. And it's talking about the nastiness of life and saying Christ can help me endure whatever it is, whether it's good or whether it's bad. Christ can help me to work through it. That's Philippians 4. So whenever my wife was telling me, Tabitha told me this week, she listened to a podcast with Chuck Colson's ministry. Not Prison Fellowship. Can't remember the name of it. They were doing a story on Johnny Erickson Tada. If you've never heard of John, I'm sure many of you have. If you have, Johnny Erickson Tada is a believer. She's a believer. And she is a quadriplegic. She had a diving accident when she was a teenager. And now she's in her 60s. But a quadriplegic all that time. And they were talking about her story and how the last 15 years, because you know, she's been a quadriplegic for so long, she's going through chronic pain because her bones now, she's been in a wheelchair for decades. And so the body's not meant to be in a wheelchair, much less being in a wheelchair for 20, 30 years. Right? And they were doing a part of her story where she says sometimes she gets up and says, Lord, I don't want to be a quadriplegic. I don't want someone to have to take care of my basic needs again today. That's Philippians 4:13. That's where Philippians 4:13 comes into play. When everything, have you ever been in a room that's so dark you can't even see your head? You ever been on it? Happens in my garage. When I close the garage door, I don't get to the light switch in time in the garage door, and it's pitch black. There's nothing. When life's that dark, that's when you need to quote Philippians 4:13. Not when you're trying to shave 5 minutes off your route to work or find a good parking spot. That's not Philippians 4:13. So keep that in mind. Whether hungry, fed, in abundance, or need, the Lord allows me to not get a big head with success or to be in despair whenever there's failure or suffering in front of me. He can strengthen me to walk through it. And then verse 14, so that's my attitude, so I'm not here to ask you for funds. I'm here to say thank you. And still, you did well by partnering with me in my hardship. Even though you didn't have to, you wanted to help me, guys. You wanted to help me. And you Philippians know, and now we're going to live to another promise that a lot of times gets soundbited. Philippians 4:13 gets soundbited a lot. This next one gets soundbited by televangelists. All right, those 1-800 rip you off preachers. 1-800 rip you off. Call them to get your prayer clock and be this next verse. This is what they use. Okay. You Philippians know that in the early days of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, that might be what we call the county in which Philippi was located. Okay, just in the county. No church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you alone. Now, Paul doesn't, he doesn't say why. It may have been because the church didn't know that Paul needed God. So it's not a matter of condemning other churches. He's just saying other churches, when I was making my travels, they didn't provide support. I mean, you read another letter by Paul, 1 Corinthians. He says to those believers, when he started their church, he didn't take a salary from them. He worked on the side. He was what we call bivocation. Right? And he didn't take a paycheck from the Corinthians because he says there were just certain situations where people might get the wrong idea. So the best thing to do was just start the church, pastor you, and have my own business on the side. But here, he couldn't necessarily do all that. And the Philippians, he says, no other church helped him. And then notice verse 16, even Thessalonica. I mean, not just did you help me, obviously, when I came to you, but when I went to another town, when I went to Thessalonica, you sent gifts for my needs several times. And you got to recognize, this is a difficult thing to do. They can't just, you know, go to the bank, make a deposit, and send it to his account through Chase or Wells Fargo. You know, it's going to take effort to get this money from place to place to make sure Paul gets it. And they did it on more than one occasion. In verse 17, you know, not that I seek the gift, but I seek the profit. In other words, Again, I'm not thanking you because I'm trying to fish to see whether or not I can get another check. I'm thanking you because I know that whatever you give to me is going to be an investment that can lead to blessing. And that it's increasing to your account. But I have received everything in full, and I have an abundance. I'm fully supplied. So in other words, nobody robbed the caravan. Nobody was able to steal any of what you gave, because that would be a concern. Making if you're going to make sure you have trustworthy people and be able to get there safely. I have everything that you gave. I have an abundance of fully supplied, having received from Epaphroditus what you provided. Now, then you have this Old Testament imagery, a fragrant offering, acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. So, you gave something to invest in my ministry so that I could further doing what I was doing and have my needs met, so that you could be a part of what I did. And here's the thing, when you did it sacrificially. In other words, these Philippians weren't loaded. They gave what some of them didn't have to give. And they didn't anymore. Now I know this is very sensitive stuff, and especially as not being a pastor, so I'm not here to do any guilt trip when it comes to money. This is not a tithe or die sermon. I just want you to see how Paul talks about giving with these Philippians. That's all I want you to see, so we don't sound like the promise that's going to happen here in a few moments. He says that it's a fragrant offering, acceptable sacrifice, pleasing God. In other words, the idea here is when you give what you don't have to invest in the furtherance of the gospel simply because you're concerned about the gospel. When that happens, Paul says, that smells really good to God. Smells good. It's acceptable. It's Abel versus Cain. Except Abel sacrifice, not Cain. That is something that is acceptable. Giving for the purpose of seeing God's work done with no reservation, doing it with abandon, even when the numbers at home and the budget say may not be the best idea. Paul says, a fragrant offering. Now notice here, it's in light of that, in light of these Philippians giving what they didn't have to give, putting themselves on the line to support Paul, it's in that light that you get verse 9. Because verse 19 gets soundbite. If you're doing everything you do for Jesus, then what's going to happen? Well, my God will supply all your needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. But here's what gets deleted from this promise. Notice, my God will supply all your needs. Why would these Philippians be in need? Because they gave what they didn't need to be given. They couldn't afford to be giving what they were giving Paul. And so basically, Lord, I'm giving this to Paul. And if you don't come through, we're going to be in trouble. And Paul says, God will meet that need. He will meet that need. Whenever someone's in need for the furtherance of the gospel and someone sacrifices to help that, Paul says, Christ goes to his checkbook. You don't want my checkbook. I can write as many zeros on a checkbook as you like. And that's all it would be. Zeros. But if you get Bill Gates, or, well, Steve Jobs is dead. I'm trying to keep it non-political. I don't know many millionaires. Warren Buffett. Okay, I don't even know that. It's terrible. I'm in the ministry. I can't worry about all these papers. You know, some really rich person, they put a thing on, oh, yeah, and they can back it up. They have the revenue to back it up. Paul says, whenever someone goes into need because they're trying to invest in God's kingdom, Paul says, Christ puts out his check. And he'll meet the need. And say all once. That's why the televangelist quoted this verse. It doesn't work. Give to God and he'll give you a house so big that your walk-in closet's bigger than most people's bedrooms. No. That's not Paul's point at all. He's saying, as you invest in the Lord's work, the Lord will provide. The cliche slogan is true. You can't outgive God. That is true. It is true. Now, again, there's so many ways to misrepresent it. So we should just give all our money to the ministry and the church, and now we're going to pay their bills. No, that's not the point at all. Not the point at all. All I'm saying here is that these Philippians put their necks on the line for Paul when it came to what he needed. And Paul says, because you met my need, God will meet yours. God will meet yours. And here's the thing. As faithful as you can be in your service and in giving money or talents, whatever, and giving it to the Lord, just recognize it's one of those things. It's like the story of the feeding of the 5,000. You got 5 loaves and 2 fish. And then they leave with 12 baskets. I'm not saying if you give your 5 loaves and 2 fish that you're going to leave with 12 baskets. You may leave with 20. You may leave with 1. I can't tell you what the dividends are. I can't do that. That's what televangelists is supposed to do. I can't tell you what the dividends are going to be. But I can say that God will meet our needs according to his riches whenever we are faithful to the call of God against us. So all I'm saying is try God out and see what happens. The only time, or one of the few, that's better, one of the few times God actually says to his people to test it. You know, that's not something you want to do. Test God. God actually says, test me in the Old Testament when it comes to investing in what I tell you to invest in. Giving to me and see if I don't bless. He does. And now verse 20, closing out. Now to our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. And then some final goodbyes. But there is something in this last goodbye that I want to highlight. Verse 21, greet every saint in Christ Jesus. For a good Baptist translation, make sure to shake everybody's hand in the church world. Right? Greet every saint in Christ Jesus. The brothers who are with me send you greeting. All the saints send you greetings. Notice here, especially those who belong to Caesar's household. Remember earlier in the letter, Paul said he was sharing the gospel with people there in their house arrest. Caesar's household? I'm not going to greet people in Caesar's household. They're pagans. Well, some of them now are brothers and sisters. Why got to greet them too? They work for Caesar. Well, they may work for Caesar, but their citizenship is with heaven. This is the point I want you to have. In the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, be with your spirit. This is what I want to see here. I know all of us in different generations have seen this country go through all kinds of waves of conflict and turmoil and things like that. I'm 45. In my lifetime, I've never seen this country in the turmoil it's in now. I've never seen it. I have. Now, the closest thing would probably be Vietnam, but I'm in the 70s. I was born 70s. So, I mean, that was coming to, I know that was a lot of turmoil. This is what I want you to be aware of, or what I want to say here as we get to the end of this letter. Whenever we're railing at the world for the world acting like the world, like yesterday, right? When the world acts like the world acts, right? Recognize there are all kinds of things that are going on that the camera doesn't show. And what I mean by that is satanic, demonic, and just downright ugly, sinful influences. Doesn't excuse anything, please understand. But it's the fuel that the tank of the world runs on. Right? And if we want to have a prophetic, not pathetic, a prophetic voice telling the world what it's doing wrong and how it can change, recognize that can only happen if we exhibit an alternative. world to consider. In other words, greet every saint. I mean, if we're wanting to rail against Charlottesville yesterday and talk about all the horrendous attitudes that were exhibited and actions that were exhibited yesterday, that's one thing. But if those attitudes are domesticated in any of our hearts in this church, I mean, we wouldn't go out and get a carnal over somebody, but we'll stereotype somebody in our heads and, you know, subtly change our behavior because we still have something. If we still emulate some of those attitudes, we're just able to camouflage them so the leader can't see them. Don't expect the world to change. Don't expect the world to want to embrace a gospel that isn't represented by people who change minds. We have to agree to everything. The church has to be an alternative society. It has to be an alternative community. It has to be an alternative to what the world's saying they want to do. If we don't display an alternative, then the world will listen. And being a social media warrior is not going to change the world. Ranting on Facebook and tweeting self-righteous comments is not going to convert one heart. It's not. The Roman Empire got turned upside down without Twitter and without Fox News. It got changed by believers who were doing things that the Roman Empire could make fun of. These Christians, I mean, they believe a lot of, I'm quoting sources. They believe all kinds of wacko stuff. But they stink and love each other. And all the people in the Roman culture that were just, the Roman culture was a meat grinder. Just destroying lives. And then some of them would find solace in the way. Or Christianity in the church. And be ministered to. And radically changed. And eventually, they grew. Well, let's kill them. Now they grow more. Well, let's marginalize them. Now they grow more. And then eventually what happens? The Roman Empire falls. Christianity keeps on going. Keeps on going. I mean, our culture will fall. It will. Or it already has. I mean, we're just dealing with repercussions. But Christianity is not, it's not going to go anywhere. The kingdom is going to keep on rolling. But if we're wanting to have a prophetic voice that speaks to the evil of our world, we have to provide an alternative of righteousness. It's not enough to say, that's wrong, that's wrong, that's wrong. Shame, shame, bad, bad. That's not enough. It's essential, but it's not sufficient. There has to be a, and this is what's good. What's good? Come to this community and see. And if we're scared to say that, remember, in the Old and New Testament, judgment begins with the house of God. In the Old Testament, God says, I'm going to bring the day of the Lord. Day of the Lord is another way of saying, blow the boom on somebody. And Israel says, yes! He reads the book of Amos. The day of the Lord, wipe out these stinking nations. And Amos says, well, the day of the Lord starts with you. You're first in line. I'm cleaning out all you unfaithful pagan Israelites first. And then I'll deal with all the other nations. If we have that attitude, recognize that judgment begins within ourselves, looking at ourselves, I think Jesus had something to say about that. Looking at ourselves first, and then tell the Lord to join us in following the Savior who can make us clean. That is what would turn the world, or America, or Texas, upside down. But we have to not just talk about it, we've got to be seen. We've got to show. And when we do, you'd be surprised what God can do with people who recognize they can do nothing without Him. You'd be surprised. You know, anything that happens today, that happens on the news or happens this week, God doesn't have to go to a therapist. He doesn't have to go to a therapist and talk about it. Would you believe what these people did again today? Oh, he's not going to do it. And we should. But in order to address it, we have to not just proclaim truth, we we have to illustrate, display. And when we do, it would be like our own church and turn empires. Father, we thank you so much for sending your Son to make provision for our sin. Lord, in and of ourselves, we can't fix problems that we have in our hearts. Not just simply because we're too weak, we're too corrupt. We're too rebellious. But Lord, even in all that, you chose to love us, to show us mercy, and to allow us to be with you. And Lord, we have the promises that we saw today. Lord, if we give ourselves to you, you will provide for our needs. You will make us trophies of your grace. And because we're in Christ, no matter what life throws our way, whether it's good, bad, or anything in between, Lord, that you can sustain us and strengthen us to walk through. And Lord, because of your grace, we can call each other brothers and sisters, fellow heirs and citizens of your kingdom. And Father, we admit sometimes our hearts break because we look at what the kingdoms of the world look like. Lord, they're violent, they're cruel, they're selfish, they're manipulative, they're hateful, they're spiteful, degrading. Lord, help us to realize that without you, we would be a part of it in one shape or another. And help us, Lord, by your Spirit, to be faithful to the Great Commission and faithful to do what Paul did in proclaiming the gospel of your kingdom against the evils that are committed in our world, but at the same time, showing the solution through the cross and resurrection and living as an illustration for people to see, so that they'll glorify you who is there. That's our prayer. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Dr. Owen. And we're glad that you chose to worship with us today. And the seat back in front of you is a yellow card we'd love for you to fill out and know that you were here today. Also, members, there is a white envelope for you to put your offering in there. Also, on the back side, there's opportunity to write a prayer request. You might want to write something as, like, two people were added again this past Friday to my family. So I know that you probably saw what Angie said. We talked last week about Marley, and I hate coming up here and telling you all this all the time. But next week, what I will be saying is our prayer request will be, thank you, God, that you're not going to add any more to my family. Please slow my wife's prayer life down just a tad. So I know. We would like to remind you that in less than 2 weeks, I believe, is the lock-in. I've already forgotten. Kids get through. There's a lock-in, the back-to-school lock-in, so get with Alan or Austin for the permission slips, and then also if you would like to sign up for a specific time. We'd like to welcome Max and Jennifer and Kelly. Good to see you back. It's great to see you. Also, if you're not taking advantage of the classes that we have, at 9:30 we have classes for adults and children. There are beautiful people that take care of our children and care about their spiritual well-being. They want to do stuff to encourage their lives in Christ. Becky, I appreciate what you did today. I know that really touched us as well. But also, for us adults, we need to be in the Word as well. Cool things you get to find out is our pastor search team is fervently working on narrowing it down. They have it down to 6. They look in the next week to narrow it down to 3. And I'm okay to say the plan, right? We're looking at after Labor Day, to wait till Labor Day is over. We'll have 3 weeks worth of pastoral candidates. And once they narrow it down to 3, I believe at the end of August, you'll have the opportunity to start reviewing, correct? End of September, you'll have the opportunity to start reviewing their works.
Right.
At the end of August, you'll be able to start reviewing those people on YouTube and looking at their survey of how they answer questions so that you can be a vital part of that team that selects the next pastor of our church. So with that being said, can I have the ushers come down front? Let's pray for the offering. Dear Lord, thank you again for the opportunity to worship you. Thank you for the words through Paul that you set through Dr. Everett to deliver this message as well, needed to all of us today in this world. Help us to be more like you in everything that we do, and help us be a guiding light to the world as they act like the world. Please help us stand now and help make a change. Be with us as we give back a portion you richly bless us with. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Y'all be sent to